Hello, everybody. My name is Melanie Mitchell. I'm a member of the Science Board at SFI, and I former resident faculty a long time ago. And I have the pleasure of introducing our speaker tonight, Duncan Watts. But first, I wanted to say welcome to everybody to the first talk of the Science Board Symposium. So I met Duncan one winter about 15 years ago. I was visiting Steve Strogatz's group at Cornell, where Duncan was a graduate student. And I remember we walked around the freezing cold Cornell campus, and Duncan told me about his work on what would later be called small world networks. This is something probably many of you have heard of, that term, but it didn't exist back then. And Duncan really invented that whole idea of extending this notion of small world networks from sociology into many different fields. It turns out that his work was originally inspired by his studies of how male crickets synchronize their chirping in order to more successfully attract female crickets. Up to this time, Duncan had thought he was an applied mathematician, but then he discovered that his models of cricket mating could also explain a lot about human behavior. He suddenly realized that he was actually a sociologist. At that time, I was the chair of the SFI postdoc committee and the selection committee, and I was always on the lookout for exceptional graduate students. Duncan was one of the most exceptional ones I have ever encountered, and I knew we had to get him to come to SFI. Fortunately for us, it turned out to be not too hard to convince him to come, and SFI was very lucky to have him as a postdoc for a couple of years. Duncan then went on to become a faculty member in sociology at Columbia, and then to his current position as principal research science at Yahoo Research. By the way, Duncan, how do you pronounce that exclamation point? Okay, well, you can ask him after the talk. As many of you know, Duncan's work has been transformative in many fields. His 1999 paper with Steve Strogatz, called Collective Dynamics of Small World Networks, was published in Nature and essentially started what is now called the New Science of Networks. Duncan's subsequent experimental and theoretical studies have pioneered the scientific investigation of emerging networks such as Facebook and Twitter. Duncan's recent work on understanding the dynamics of influence in social networks has itself had significant influence in many different areas, ranging from epidemiology to advertising. Duncan is the author of three books. The latest one, which I hold in my hand, is called Everything is Obvious Once You Know the Answer. It's about common sense and how it can fail. It's received great reviews. For example, one reviewer on Amazon called it a reason to get excited about sociology. That is high praise. Tonight, Duncan will be telling us about the virtual lab and no doubt giving us more reasons to get excited about sociology and social science. Please welcome Duncan Watts.
Thanks, Melanie. That's great. I still remember those days wandering around Cornell campus as well. Actually, Melanie was responsible for a whole chapter in my dissertation, which became my first book. It was called Small Worlds, and I remember because we had an argument. It wasn't really an argument; it was a disagreement about whether changing the topology of cellular automata would change their computational capabilities. And Melanie was like, "Nah, it's just randomizing. It's not going to make any difference." And I was like, "I don't know. I think it will." And I wasn't going to do this. I already had enough stuff on my plate to finish my dissertation by August, so I could get to my first postdoc at Columbia. I'm going to do this. So that resulted in a whole extra chapter. So thanks very much for that, Melanie. I want to talk about something different tonight. And I want to go back to 1969, and a sociologist, Morris Zolditch, wrote this very interesting paper in which he sort of posed a rhetorical question: can you really study an army in a lab? Zolditch concluded that not only was this sort of impractical to put a large number of people into a laboratory, but that it wasn't really necessary. That, you know, his idea was that the purpose of laboratory experiments is to test theories, and if you have and then you take the theories out and you apply them in the real world. And so he seemed to think that it was good enough just to be able to use sort of small group and even individuals in labs to test out sociological theories, and then the theories could then be used to make statements about large groups in the real world. But a point that he doesn't really, I think, appreciate, at least in this paper, is that in some respects, large groups are different. And so now I'm preaching to the choir here. This is a sort of central sort of assumption of everything that we do here at the Santa Fe Institute, that lots of the questions that sociologists are interested in have to do with entities like firms, families, markets, associations, societies, and cultures that are large agglomerations of individuals. And many of the things that we're interested in and that are most sort of pressing social questions today, like, you know, how do we sort of deal with systemic risk in financial markets? How do we, what is a acceptable versus a dangerous level of wealth inequality? You know, why do political revolutions happen when and where they do and not some other time or in some other place? You know, why do social norms change and why do they change the way they do? These are all questions about these sort of higher level entities. But of course, we know these higher level entities, these sort of institutions and societies and everything, are composed of individual people. And so in some sense, all we're doing is aggregating individual behavior. But somehow when we aggregate individual behavior, we get something other than just individuals. We get all these kinds of social organization. Now this, of course, is what we call emergence here at Santa Fe. In sociology, it's called the micro-macro problem. And so there are certain, if we want to have theories that are not just about these social organizations, if we want to have theories about how they come to be social organizations, we want to understand how you get, why is it that you can, or how is it that you can put a bunch of people together and somehow get something other than a bunch of people, then we need to be able to test those theories in a lab as well, and then maybe we do need to put an army in a lab after all. So, Zeldich's other point was that, of course, this is just wildly impractical. But just as a complete coincidence, that very same year, Len Kleinrock sent the first message over IP via the ARPANET from UCLA to SRI on October 29th. And so, as we're all aware, since then, lots of things have happened, right? The internet, as they say, is kind of a big deal. It's changed so many aspects of our lives. You know, it's changed the way we communicate, it's changed the way we buy things, it's changed the way we express ourselves, it's changed our ideas about privacy and intellectual property. It's sort of thrown entire industries like the music industry and the media industry into absolute turmoil. It's creating other industries on the fly. It's a very sort of interesting and disruptive suite of technologies, and what I want to argue today is that it's also changing the way that we can do social science. And so I want to come back to Zeldich's question and ask, can we now on the web and using a virtual laboratory, can we study large groups online, and if we can, how is that going to change what we mean by social science and what we can accomplish with social science? So I've been thinking about this for some time now, about a decade, and it began with an experimental version of the work that Melanie just talked about, when my work at Cornell was all very theoretical, simple toy models and simulations. And when I got to Columbia, we decided that we wanted to try an experiment, and what we did was actually replicate Stanley Milgram's famous experiment from the 1960s, the small world experiment, where we picked a bunch of targets. We got a bunch of other people to try to send messages to those targets, but the only way they could do that is to send a message to a friend of theirs, who would then send a message to a friend of theirs, who would then send a message to a friend of theirs, and each person was trying to get the message closer to the target than they were themselves. Milgram did this back in the 1960s with one target and 300 senders. We did it with 18 different targets around the world and 24,000 senders, which in the end, reached about 60,000 odd people in 160 something countries. So this was sort of really kind of expanding Milgram's early experiment to the scope of the scale of the whole world. And what was sort of remarkable is that we really came up with the same answer, right? That Milgram's findings were sort of surprisingly robust after 40 years. So this was, you know, this was very exciting to us because we'd managed to get 60,000 people to participate in a social science experiment essentially for free. And so we started thinking, what else can we do? And so this was when, with my graduate student, Matt Salganik, who now teaches sociology at Princeton, we ran an experiment called Music Lab, where we got about 14,000 participants that we recruited from a social networking site to make selections between 48 different songs by unknown bands. And some of these participants had to make their decisions independently. They were given no information about these songs other than the names of the bands. Other participants got to see how many times the songs had been downloaded before them, so they got a weak signal about what other people liked. And so what we found is that, you know, when people know what other people like, the two things happen at the macro level. So this is a micro-macro experiment, right? Individuals are making decisions, but they have consequences for the market as a whole. That markets become more unequal. Popular songs become more popular. Unpopular songs become less popular. But at the same time, it becomes increasingly hard to predict which songs are going to become the most popular. So this was sort of our way of trying to understand why in the real world we see hits in cultural markets, movies, books, music, and so on, that are way more successful than average, orders and orders of magnitude. You know, Harry Potter books sell 350 million copies, most books sell about 350 copies, right? So there's sort of several orders of magnitude difference there, and yet, Harry Potter gets rejected by 8 children's book publishers before finally getting picked up by Bloomsbury. So it's obviously very hard to predict these hits in advance, and yet when they happen, they seem sort of obvious. So these were sort of a series of experiments that we were working on over the years, but our experience was a mixture of positive and negative. On the one hand, we learned a lot from doing these experiments, but each one of them took a tremendous amount of time and effort to program, so they're very hard to replicate, and as a result, no one has really replicated them. So that wasn't so good. Also, they were based on what we call a field of dreams principle, right? That you put in all this effort up front building this very elaborate experiment, and then you just sort of turn on the switch and hope that people show up. And then the question is, well, what if they don't show up? And the answer is, well, then you just wasted a year of your grad student's time. The third thing is that they relied on what my friend Jonah Peretti calls the bored at work network, which is that there are millions of people out there in the world sitting at their desks, and they're bored, and they have a computer in front of them. And if you can give them something to do that's more interesting than what they're doing right now, then they will do social science for you. The trick, though, is you have to make it interesting. And a lot of social science is not interesting. Well, it's interesting for social scientists, but the experiments that we ask people to participate in can sometimes be rather boring, which is why you sort of have to pay them to do it. And of course, we have no way to determine who shows up and who doesn't. So we've really been looking for all these years a more sort of replicable, reliable, flexible way to run experiments, to create this virtual lab. And so in 2005, along comes Amazon's Mechanical Turk, right? So maybe some of you have heard of this site. It was so the original Mechanical Turk, just to give some backstory, was a chess-playing automaton. That was from the 19th century, that was famous for having beaten Napoleon at chess. Now, of course, it turns out that the automaton was a fraud. It was actually a person inside who was making all the moves, hence what Jeff Bezos calls artificial intelligence, right? And so Amazon originally created this site to basically clean up its own web pages. If you go to an Amazon web page, there's a lot of stuff on it, right? And Amazon wants to make sure that it's all accurate. This is very hard for a machine to do, but it's relatively easy for people to do. So they called these tasks that they wanted people to solve HITS, human intelligence tasks. So it's a way of sort of harnessing human intelligence on a large scale to do lots and lots of little jobs that they pay relatively little money for. So labeling an image, for example, is like something that is very easy for people to do, very hard for machines to do. And so you can pay somebody 1 cent or 2 cents to label an image, and you can throw up 100,000 images and get Turkers to label your entire collection of photos over a weekend. Right? So these are the sorts of tasks that are available on Mechanical Turk, and this is what has sort of become this, this term crowdsourcing has come to denote this sort of labor activity where you have lots of very small jobs that are being individually outsourced to individual people, and you're paying them very small piece rates to do them. So we heard about this a few years ago, and my first thought was, this is how we're going to solve this problem, right? This is how we're going to build our lab. Because it's like the 21st century version of putting flyers up around campus and saying, come to the psych lab at 3 o'clock on Tuesday, and we'll pay you $10 to participate in an experiment about learning or something. Except now we can do it on a much larger scale. So when I first, the first project that we did, I'm just going to talk about two projects just to give you an idea of what can be done and what progress we've made over the last couple of years. And then I'll sort of wrap up with some speculation about where things might be going. So this is a project that I did with my postdoc, Winter Mason, at Yahoo. And we were very interested, for various reasons, in this question of financial incentives and performance, and particularly how this question played out in the context of Mechanical Turk. So this is, of course, a problem that many people have worried about in several different fields, in economics, psychology, management science, and so on, over many years. And a lot of this work is sort of interested in the question of whether you should pay people a fixed wage or whether you should pay them performance-based pay. And in general, the consensus is performance-based pay, at least consensus among economists, is that performance-based pay works better than a fixed wage because you attract better workers and you motivate them to work harder. But what we were interested in is what about the pay rate itself? In some sense, everything on Mechanical Turk is performance-based pay because you only get paid when you get things right. Or at least that's the idea. So if you imagine, so if you pay people more per task, can you expect them, how do you change their behavior, right? So this was the design that we came up with. So the basic experimental design is we create a task for them to do. They come to Mechanical Turk, they accept the hit, we give them an upfront fee, and then we send them over to Yahoo's, to our own servers, and we explain the task to them, they do some training, we make sure they understand what they're doing, and then we randomly assign them to one of three pay levels and one of three difficulty levels. So some people are getting paid very well to do very easy tasks, and other people are getting paid very poorly to do very difficult tasks, and everything in between. So that's a 9 different experimental conditions. So what's the task? Well, it's a somewhat arbitrary task, but it's one that suits these conditions. These are a series of traffic images taken from a traffic camera in Maryland. Winter is from Maryland originally. There's this wonderful website called trafficland.com. It has live video feeds from traffic cameras all over the world, and you can sort of sit there and watch traffic moving in your hometown if you want. So surprisingly addictive, like many things online. And so we took a bunch of stills from these videos, and they were taken at 2-second intervals. So we have these things timestamped. We know what order they're in. But then we shuffle them into a random order, and we show them to the Turkers, and we say, put them back in the right order. So sometimes this is quite easy, particularly when the traffic's moving fast, and other times it's more difficult. The way we varied the overall difficulty, though, is that sometimes they got 2 images, sometimes they got 3 images, and sometimes they got 4 images, right? So the 4 image ones are the most difficult. And we paid them either 1 cent per task or 5 cent per task or 10 cents per task. And they only get paid, remember, if they get the ordering correct. So we managed to get 600 participants, and this is sort of something we did in a day or two. And most of them were from the US, and we had no idea at this stage who these people were, where they came from, who are the Turkers. Most of them are from the US. It's changed a little bit in the last couple of years. But they were from all over the place. a reasonably sort of even split on gender, surprisingly wide distribution on age, and also a wide distribution on income. And you might think these people are just making it up, that they're just lying about their income, and probably some of them are, but we get very similar results across very different experiments. So they're all lying very consistently, if they're lying. And these guys sorted about 36,000 sets of images. And again, this is something that happened over a couple of day period. So what happens? I'm not really going to go into the details of any of these studies too much because I'm trying to get through a lot and I'm probably going to run over time as it is. We found two main results. On the left, you see three curves that indicate how many tasks people completed. Because you could do anything from zero. Once you'd finished the training, you could just drop out and stop, right? So you could do zero tasks, or you could do all 99 sets of images. So each person could do up to 99. So here we see, this is the y-axis is the number of tasks that were completed, and this along the x-axis is the pay, how much we paid them. So this is 1 cent, this is 5 cents, this is 10 cents. So you can see that as you pay people more, they do more work, right? So that seemed quite reasonable, very sort of rational, choicey. And the easy, this is two images, this is three images, and this is four images. So people do more work when it's easier and when they get paid more. It makes perfect sense. On the right-hand side, we look at their accuracy. And you can see that the pay has no effect on accuracy whatsoever, right? Now remember, this is like an order of magnitude difference. Some people are getting paid 10 times as much as other people, and it's not improving their accuracy at all, right? And actually, once you take account of the, you're obviously more likely to get to rearrange two images correctly by random chance than you are to rearrange four images correctly by random chance. Once you account for that factor, the number of images doesn't make any difference either. So basically, the difficulty and the pay are not having any effect on accuracy, which is surprising. So we didn't really know why this was, and we had lots of hypotheses. But here's an interesting one. After they had finished, we gave them an exit survey, and one of the questions we asked them in the exit survey was, how much do you think you should have gotten paid to do what you just did? And this is very interesting, because on the x-axis is how much they got paid, on the y-axis is how much they think they should have gotten paid. So when you pay people 1 cent per task, they think they should get paid 5 cents per task. When you pay them 5 cents per task, they think they should get paid 8 cents per task. And when you pay them 10 cents per task, they think they should get paid 13 cents per task, right? So everybody thinks they're underpaid, no matter what they're actually paid. So this is a common effect in other areas of psychology. They call it anchoring. People anchor on sort of often arbitrary numbers. Here they're anchoring on the announced wage. So what do we conclude? Well, increasing the pay rate elicits more work, but not more accurate work. And it seems to derive from this anchoring effect, that people always feel underpaid, and so they're not particularly motivated by these increases in wages that you're, in effect, giving them. And we actually found a very similar effect for a different task that I'm not going to talk about. You can read about it if you're interested in. And so it's not just this one particular weird thing that we tried to do. It's something that we found in at least one other task, and other people have found similar results in other experiments subsequently. So from the perspective of, you know, the practical perspective of crowdsourcing, the takeaway point is that you should pay people as little as possible. Okay. So, yes.
Did they know how much other people?
No, they did not. No, they did not. Yeah, that would definitely change the experiment. Okay. So, substantively we thought this was interesting, but the other thing that it demonstrated was that you actually can use this thing to run experiments in a lab effectively. And this was the first attempt that we know of to do that. Now, it's subsequently become there's sort of a cottage industry of people who are working on behavioral experiments using Mechanical Turk. John Horton and his colleagues have redone a bunch of classical psych experiments and found that they can get the same results as people have found in the lab. And now there's a couple of, at least two sort of guides that have been published for how to do experiments on Mechanical Turk with lots of practical suggestions. So there's still issues here, and you know, we're sort of, you know, everything is sort of, this whole platform is evolving and new things are coming along, and we're learning new things all the time. But there are some very large advantages here in speed and cost. But there's still one problem, is that, you know, the examples that I talked about in the, on the first slide are, you know, where we sort of see this emergence, all require us to, you know, the participants in studies to interact with each other. We have to have these sort of, in a sense, networks of interactions for us to see this kind of complexity. And Music Lab had a sort of version of that. But remember, in Music Lab, well, I didn't really explain the details of Music Lab, but people just arrived in a sequence. So you could see what people ahead of you had done, but they couldn't see what you were going to do, and they couldn't be influenced by that. There was no reciprocity, and there was no synchronicity, right? So what you really want is to have people all at the same time participating in the same experiment, right? So we want to do fully networked experiments. We have to get large numbers of people to show up and stay there. So this is something that Michael Kearns and his colleagues have done, really pioneered at Penn over the last several years, where they have done a series of very interesting experiments on graph coloring, on consensus games, on network exchange. And they really are networked experiments. But because it's in a physical lab, you can recruit people, students, to come and at a certain time, and then you stand there, and you make them feel bad about leaving. And also, they pay them very well, and so they don't really have any trouble with dropout. But the problem is that they can only fit 36 students in a lab, because that's how many computers they have, and so they're sort of all their experiments have N of 36. And they're very expensive to run, and they're very slow, because it takes a lot of time to get this stuff organized. And so they only do it sort of once or twice a year. So what we would like to do is try to do the same kind of thing, except online, more cheaply, faster, and possibly even on a larger scale. But there's this challenge of how do you get these people to show up? So this is the problem that we eventually figured out how to solve, which is to and there's a couple of different projects that we've done this for. The one I'm going to talk about today involves public goods games. We've also done another project, with Winter Mason, on collaborative problem solving. But the idea in both cases is you run a bunch of preliminary experiments that have small groups of people, so you have no trouble getting them to show up. And then at the end of the game, you ask them if they would like to join a panel, and if they would like to be notified of future experiments, and so you sort of acquire this list of names of people who not only know how to play your game, but are actually interested in it, and then we will notify them, usually the night before, that we're going to be playing games at 11 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 5 o'clock. Please show up. We ping them again, 5 minutes beforehand. People arrive, and we sit them in a virtual waiting room so that they sit there, and there's a little counter saying there's 15 more people needed to play the game. This is counting down, and when it gets to zero, the game is on, right? And so in this way, we've managed to run games of up to 36 players at a time. So we get 36 people at a time playing online, God knows where they are, all over the place. And this usually takes a couple of minutes to get these games to run. So this is sort of, something that we're still sort of, ironing the kinks out of. But it's been pretty successful so far. Okay. So let me just tell you about this one project. And this is, a newfangled way of studying possibly the oldest question in all of social science, right? This is sort of maybe the original question of social science, which goes all the way back to Hobbes, who asked, why do people cooperate? Why is there not war of all against all, right? And this, of course, is a problem that many people have thought about here at the Institute. Eleanor Ostrom, who's sometimes involved with Santa Fe, won the Nobel Prize in 2009 and for her studies of public goods games. So that's what we're going to study here. And we're going to study what's called a linear public goods game. So the idea is that you have a game that goes over a number of rounds. On each round, each person gets given usually points, which get converted to money afterwards. So think of it as money. It's an endowment. And you can put any amount, anything, any fraction of this endowment into a common pool. So you can put in nothing, you can put in everything, or anywhere in between. And then the pool is summed up and multiplied by a constant. That's where the linear bit comes in. And then everything gets redistributed back to the contributors, but critically, everybody gets the same amount no matter what they put in, right? So there's the here's the dilemma, that everybody does the best. The social welfare maximizing solution is arrived at if everybody puts in the maximum amount every time, but you're actually better off if everybody else puts in the maximum amount and you put in nothing, right? So there's a tension between your selfish individual payoff and the social welfare maximizing payoff. And so people have studied this game exhaustively in experiments, again, in labs, and in particular Ernst Fehr and Simon Gachter in Zurich have run many of these games, and they've observed, and other people have observed as well, that contributions tend to start out high and end low. People get really mad at each other. It's amazing how you know, they run these games in brain scanners. They put people in brain scanners and have them play this game, and you know, like the angry part of the brain lights up when people don't contribute. And so then if you offer them an opportunity to punish non-contributors, they will. They'll actually pay more money to punish somebody else. And this actually works. It causes people to contribute more. It's very effective. And you see this kind of norm enforcement happening all the time in society. There's lots of obnoxious people in New York, as you can imagine, and somebody's always doing something selfish, right? And annoying other people, like you know, talking on their cell phone. Actually, the quiet car is the best example. I don't know if anyone's taken the Amtrak along the north. And Michael's nodding over here. So the Amtrak trains on the Northeastern Corridor all have a quiet car, and this has sort of become like a war zone, right? Because you know, it gets so quiet that if you make any noise at all, then people can hear you. And everyone just gets absolutely incensed when somebody breaks the rules, right? And so normal people just sit there and fume, right? But there's always someone who's the enforcer. And they get up and they're like, excuse me, do you know this is the quiet car? And it's very awkward because, you know, you're not supposed to rebuke people in public. And it's usually some sort of tension. And then the person shuts up, right? And if you see this happen a couple of times, you never, ever talk on the quiet car, right? And so then if it works perfectly, then no one actually needs to enforce the norm, right? So this is what happens. Anyway, I'm digressing here. I really want to talk about networks. So all these experiments are done in small groups of four players. And so part of our strategy is to recruit people for this large panel that we want. We ran a bunch of experiments with n equals 4, and we replicated exactly at least as exactly as we could, reading their paper, Fehr and Gachter's conditions. And what do we find? We found exactly the same results. So this is sort of actually my favorite plot, because these blue dots come from their paper, which was published in AER in 2000. So they're probably done in 1998 or something, in a lab in Zurich, right? These experiments, the green line, were done in 2010, so 12 years later, with people playing online, you know, in their offices or at home or wherever, completely different conditions, different people, different decade, and yet they play exactly the same way. Even sort of the numbers are indistinguishable. So this we thought was quite remarkable. But again, we're interested in how this changes when people play these games over networks, because in the real world, you're interacting with a group of people, some of them may be interacting with each other, but they're also interacting with other people who you're not interacting with. And so if something bad happens out there, you can imagine it sort of cascading in to affect you. So let's not worry too much. It's after dinner, so I won't walk you through this equation here, but there is some gratuitous math there. This is basically just converting the standard game into a network form. So people are basically splitting their contributions among the edges of the graph. And so I'm just going to ask this question. Why should we even care about this problem? Why should we think that networks would make any difference to this game at all? Because, of course, there were lots of people who studied public goods games for many years and never thought about networks. And so, you know, maybe it's not interesting. But there's a couple of ideas here that at least the networks community were pretty convinced of. And one of them goes back to Axelrod and Hamilton in the 1970s, where they observed that if people play like conditional cooperators, so basically I'm going to do the right thing if you do the right thing, otherwise I'm going to punish you, then it helps to let them interact preferentially, right? That population structure itself should help cooperation, because if you let all the good guys play together and exclude the bad guys, then they're going to be able to sustain their cooperation for longer than if you allow the bad guys to infiltrate them, right? So this is sort of an old idea, and when you convert it into network language, you think networks that have a lot of local clustering should support cooperation better than networks like random graphs, for example, that have no local clustering. The other idea is that things should be contagious, especially good things, right? That, you know, if I'm cooperating, then that should boost my neighbor's contributions, and then my neighbor has a neighbor who's playing with him but not with me, and that person should also get a boost. So there's a boost that's coming from me that's sort of propagating possibly along multiple steps. And so actually Christakis and Nicholas Christakis and James Fowler wrote a paper in 2009 where they make this claim very explicitly. They say we found evidence of contagion, positive contagion, for up to 3 degrees from the origin. And they did this by reanalyzing Fair and Gachter's data in a particular condition where they randomly reassign people to different groups each time. So there's certainly some evidence, it's inconclusive, but some evidence and some intuition to suggest that we should care about networks. So to reflect that intuition, we tried to span as much topology as we could with networks that were admittedly fairly small. All these networks have 24 nodes and everyone has 6 neighbors. That should be 5, sorry. These are groups of 6, so everyone has 5 neighbors exactly. And so we have, one extreme we have these cliques, so this is sort of very close to the standard game. This other extreme we have a random graph where there's no local clustering at all. And then in between we have some intermediate cases where we have 2 cliques joined together, a cycle, something that looks a little bit like a small world network. And all of these have been created by rewiring the edges that are in there, so they all have exactly the same number of edges. Every individual, in fact, has exactly the same number of neighbors. Okay, so these are the statistics just to show you that we are sort of pretty much spanning as much as we can in terms of path length and local clustering. So here's the surprising thing to us. This is why I sort of tried to set you up with all this intuition for why networks should matter, because actually they don't. And this was really, so if you look at these plots, they look a little bit different, but in fact the error bars are large enough that none of these are statistically different from each other. And actually most of that difference that you see here is due to the differences that arise on the first turn. Now, those differences obviously have to be random because people don't know what, they have no experience of the network. They show up and they make a decision. And so if you sort of account for this variation in the beginning, then these curves lie almost on top of each other. So there's no effect of network structure on contributions at all, as far as we can tell. So why not? This is puzzling to us. We're networks people. We want networks to matter always. So maybe people are not behaving like conditional cooperators. Maybe the whole model of individual behavior is wrong. Then they could just not be paying attention to each other at all. That would be one explanation. Another is that they are behaving like conditional cooperators, but somehow it isn't helping. That the reinforcement that we expect to see for conditional cooperators isn't happening, and contagion is not taking place. Nothing good is spreading in this network. And so those experiments that we ran weren't set up to test those hypotheses. So because we have this great platform where we don't have to wait another year or write another grant proposal to do another set of experiments, we just turned around a couple of weeks later and ran another set of, or actually rather 2 additional series of experiments. So the second one, we took we took over four of the nodes in each network, and we played them ourselves, right? So we inserted basically robots into these different conditions, and so we played one robot in each of these cliques, and you can see that we played equivalent positions in all of the other networks, and so everybody is adjacent to one of these to one of these robots. They don't know this, of course, and these robots either play very generously or they play very meanly, right? So in some conditions, they contribute the full amount every time. In other conditions, they contribute zero every time. This has a big effect, right? We actually got emails from our players sort of complaining about how badly everyone was behaving today. You know, so they could, the players could really sense it. Like, and you can see it in the numbers here. So this is now averaged over all topologies. This is the original set of results. It looks very much like Fair and Gacta. This is where we have nice people playing, right? Nice robots. And these, of course, these numbers are averaged only over the real humans, not over the robots. We don't want to count that. And this curve is where we have the miserly robots playing. And so clearly this is having an effect. So people are actually responding. They are playing like conditional cooperators. They will donate more. They will contribute more when they perceive that other people are contributing more. But they also contribute less when they perceive other people to be contributing less. And so it turns out that this this sort of symmetry of conditionality is netting out all of the network effects. That we do in fact see that neighborhoods that have more clustering have more correlated play. So there is an influence of the network on the players, right? They are the two individuals who are joined by an edge play. Their contributions are more correlated than when they're not joined by an edge, and people who are in a triad are more correlated than when they're not in a triad. But it doesn't matter. It doesn't affect the cooperation level because, you know, good stuff spreads and bad stuff spreads as well, and these effects just happen to cancel out. It's not completely obvious to me that that's what should happen, but that's what does happen. Well, they are. Well, you in a repeater game, you are of course better off if you do the right thing, right? But you're conditional on what everyone else has decided. You're better off not to contribute. But over the long run, knowing that other people are going to respond to how you play, you probably are better off. In fact, you are better off contributing. But it's hard to coordinate that. I mean, that's the whole point of the dilemma, I guess.
Presumably, his question, though, is how much better off the behavior must change every time you really cooperate and get tremendously better.
Sure, you can change the game to get rid of the dilemma, and then people will cooperate. Yeah. But we wanted to study for this particular exercise. We wanted to study the standard game, right? Now we certainly could study other games. That's true, but this one is puzzling enough, right? It's a very simple game. You'd think we'd be able to understand it. We can't. So this is another the other variation that we. So in this variation, it just so happened that everybody was exactly the same distance from. Everyone was exactly one hop from one robot and two hops from the others. Right, so everyone was sort of exposed to the same level of influence, and so we couldn't actually really test for contagion under those circumstances. So that what we did was another set of experiments where we rearranged the robots so that, in this case here, you see there are two groups that have two robots, and two groups that have zero robots. So some people are one step from two robots, and other people are not adjacent to either of them. And so there's clearly potential for this effect of these solid circles to cascade through multiple steps, right? So this is the question. We really thought this was going to work. It did not work, right? That in fact, that people who are, so this is where you have no seeds, no robots. This is where you have one robot This is where you have two, that neighbors of two robots actually contributed less than when they only had one contributing neighbor, right? When they only had one robot. So there was sort of a, it's like, you know, people are conditional cooperators, but they also know when they're playing with suckers, right? And they go back to being defectors again, which was surprising to us. But the other thing that was even more surprising is if you look at the people who were not neighbors of any robots, they actually contributed less than they did when there were no robots at all in the original condition. So there was something very strange going on here. And we thought, maybe this is because we've been playing this game for so long now. This has been going on for months, and some of these people have played, you know, like 30 or 40 times. Maybe the players have changed. Maybe they've become less generous over this period of time. So then, of course, we went back and we re-ran a bunch of the original protocol experiments, and it was exactly the same. Nothing had changed. We even looked at people who had, so some people in the end had played up to 50 games, and we thought maybe people who have played a lot have become less generous, but actually the contribution levels stay remarkably constant over many, many generations. So we sort of tried to find all kinds of explanations, and I have to say we're not completely sure what's going on with this final result. So when do networks matter? Well, I mean, we really thought that this would, that we would see some striking effects here. And we're seeing lots of interesting things, but we're not seeing the things that we expected to see. Certainly, they do matter in other instances. So, you know, again, in all of the Kerns, I should say Sid Suri, the guy who my postdoc who worked on these projects with me, these experiments with me, was a student of Michael Kerns at Penn and did the original graph coloring experiments. So those guys found very big effects of the networks. And this more recent set of experiments that Winter and I have been working on, where we have groups of people collaboratively searching a rugged landscape, once again, we find very large and significant network effects. So it's sort of very puzzling to us, you know, really, when do networks matter and when don't they? And, you know, so this is a, you know, really a sort of interesting theoretical question, like under what conditions, what sorts of games, what kinds of interactions do what kinds of network features matter? And, you know, this is a sort of throwaway line that I put in the very last chapter of my dissertation back in 1997, that this was sort of an interesting question that we should try to answer. And, you know, 14 years later, I'm thinking, you know, we really should try to answer this question because I'm still very puzzled by it. So just to get back to the virtual lab, you know, we've run about 400 of these networked experiments now on Mechanical Turk over the last year or so. And, you know, when we're sort of going at a good clip, we can do about 20 sessions a week, and currently with up to 36 players per session. So, you know, it's very, you know, there's both a blessing and a curse, by the way, right? It's a blessing because you get to sort of test lots of things, but it's a curse because you keep finding out that you're wrong, right? Because you have some hypothesis and you think, oh, well, we can just run a new experiment and we can check that. And then you check it and it's wrong. And so, whereas if you don't have the ability to run the experiment, you can sort of convince yourself of your story. And as long as you can convince other people of that, then you still get your paper published. So very, very fast, very cheap, about an order of magnitude less than what it costs to run these sorts of experiments in a physical lab. A lot more diversity. I mean, people complain that Mechanical Turk is not a diverse population, and it's not, probably. But it's more diverse than college students. So we have decades and decades of social psych that really has told us about the social psychology of undergraduates at large Midwestern universities, which are not the most diverse group of people in the world. So we're doing better than that. And we have these remarkably reliable panels, and this has maybe been one of the most interesting things, is that we sort of unintentionally got this situation where we have people who have played games many, many times. And this allows us to ask different sorts of questions. So here's sort of what will this do for social science? Well, I think this speed feature is really a big deal. Because you know, I mean, we sort of go back to high school and remember, you know, when we learned the scientific method, you know, it was all about you form a hypothesis and then you design the experiment and you test it and then you modify the hypothesis and then you test it again and you just sort of go around in a cycle. Now, if it takes a year between every, you know, turn of the cycle, then it takes a long time to sort of refine your hypotheses. If you can shrink that delay from a year to a week, then you can make a lot of progress. You can also augment, and we've sort of started trying to do this as well, you can augment this process by you know, building agent-based simulations where the agents are playing the way that your actual players were playing in the experiment. So you can extract the rules of the strategies that the players are using from the empirical data. You can then go away and program your agent-based model, and then you can use the model to explore different regions of parameter space. You can find some interesting area of parameter space and then come back to the lab and test it, right? So this is something that is very, very hard to do when you have a slow cycle. Lots. Yeah. But let me finish proselytizing, and then so Winter and Sid have written this very nice methods paper, which deals with, you know, lots of the problems. I guess I see the problems as just challenges to be overcome. But, you know, the standard ones are reliability. You know, what about people? What about robots? What about spammers? Representativeness. You know, like, you know, who are these people? Are they weird? Can we, you know, can we, you know, who does this sort of thing? You know, you have dropout. Some of that is unavoidable. So there's a, you know, there are lots of practical issues. But the big one for us was this getting people to play at the same time, right? Because that really just cut out almost all the interesting experiments that we wanted to run, right? So now that we're sort of in that region, we think the others are sort of more solvable. You know, in fact, one of the things that we were worried about, which is this players who play over and over again, I think is now turned into a very interesting research question, right? Or a whole set of research questions, which is, you know, never before have we had people play 50 public goods games, right, over the series of you know, a few months. So we couldn't ask questions about, well, how do people play? How does their behavior change with experience, right? Because in the real world, of course, you rarely sort of just do something once, right? Social interactions are things that are repeated. We learn them, we grow up with them, and then, you know, we behave in situations that are essentially situations that we have experience with. So now we can start to do similar kinds of investigations in the lab. Another interesting thing that we can do is, because we know how they've played previously, we can recruit people for future experiments based on how they've played in the past. So we can take, what if we took all generous people and from the early experiments and we made them all play together? Would they all boost each other's performance, or would they revert to the mean? We don't know, but we can ask that sort of question, right? We can even say, well, how about people who have played a particular strategy in one kind of game, and how do they play other kinds of games? So once we have a reliable panel that we can sample from repeatedly, there's a whole sort of set of questions that we can ask that just haven't been practical from an experimental social science point of view in the past, because you literally just have to advertise each experiment and take whoever comes along. So that's really where we're going now. I mean, we're doing other things at Yahoo as well, of course, but we're very interested in trying to sort of beef up this idea of a virtual lab and construct a potentially much larger standing panel that we can sample from. Of course, you know, lab experiments are just one kind of experiment, right? There's the other sort of big type of experiment that one can do is field experiments, and my colleagues at Yahoo are working on that as well. David Riley in particular has done some really nice randomized field experiments where people show up and show up to Yahoo and you toss a coin, and if it's a head, they see an ad, and if it's a tail, they don't see an ad. And then you can measure directly by partnering with the retailer the actual effectiveness of advertising online. So there's lab experiments, there's field experiments, and then of course there's a huge mountain of observational data that we can bring to bear as well. And you know, this is sort of really the three legs of the stool that we would like to be able to construct, is that you can come to problems with all three of these approaches. So, you know, what's the big picture here? You know, lots of things are, I mean, every year there are things that we can do because of the internet and related technologies that were simply not possible even a year earlier, right? So if I think about, you know, what the kind of work that I was doing back at Cornell, I would not have been able to imagine what's possible now. And so I'm guessing that I'm not able to imagine what will be possible 10 years from now, but it should be interesting. And you know, the metaphor that I often use and that other people have used as well is really sort of likening the internet to the telescope. And, you know, Galileo points his telescope at Jupiter and for the first time sees the moons of Jupiter. The sort of rendering of the invisible visible really sort of had a major impact on not just celestial mechanics but also physics and then all of science. And it's not clear whether the analogy is appropriate, right? That the problems of social science are pretty big and complicated, and it's not clear that the sorts of things that we can do online and the sorts of experiments that I've been talking about, at least, have much to say about these big questions of systemic risk and economic development and inequality and intolerance that I mentioned at the beginning. But there's a lot of very exciting activity happening. There's lots of new people. Computer scientists are piling into this field. The physicists have been here for a while. Social scientists are also increasingly starting to think that they need to be paying it, you know, learning how to deal with large amounts of data and therefore talking to people in other disciplines. Of course, this is a great place for this sort of thing to happen. There's a lot going on. There's new conferences. There's new journals. So none of these things are a solution, but for me at least, it's something that I feel very optimistic about, and it's really kind of a wonderful and exciting time to be doing this kind of work. So finally, having run way over time, I'll just make a shameless plug for the book. Why should we care about any of this? Like, you know, well, I wrote a whole book about that, and you know, one of the things that I've been interested in since I sort of made the switch from physics and mathematics to sociology is that once I started explaining what I was doing to people in terms of sociology, they would always tell me, oh, that sounds kind of obvious, right? And I would think, it's not obvious. I spent 3 years trying to figure that out, and I can tell you it's not obvious, you know? And they're like, yeah, well, you know, it's obvious to me. And so after getting annoyed about this a number of times, I started to think, oh, you know, there's actually something going on here, right? There's something about human behavior that makes it difficult for us to even appreciate how difficult it is to appreciate, right? That there is, that, you know, clearly we have trouble dealing with people, right? I mean, there are lots of things that we wish we could do well in marketing, in advertising, in business strategy, in management, in politics, in policy, in development. There are many instances and many examples where we wish that we could have done better than we did. And yet we have this sort of tendency to deride the difficulty of these problems, to say, you know, it's not rocket science. Well, my response is, we're actually pretty good at rocket science, right? You know, we tell the rocket where to go and it goes there, you know? And we can't do that with the economy. You know, we can't even do that with an advertising campaign. So I think that there's sort of, you know, the sort of interesting paradox here is that we have all this intuition for human behavior, which makes us think that it's not that difficult, and it's actually that intuition that prevents us from doing the kind of science that would help us to really understand it. And so, you know, my hope is that with all this data and all this new capability, we may be sort of prodded towards a more scientific approach, and maybe that will help. Thank you. If you want to ask some questions, I have time.
So the games you're having the participants play are ones that are directly for economic rewards. And if one looks at like comment boards on web pages, they often quickly degenerate into cesspools.
Yep.
And yet on some sites they don't. And I wonder, have you thought about seeing how it plays out if you were to seed conversations with positive notes or reinforcement notes or whatever? It seems to me that that would get at some of the more psychological aspects than where everybody knows the game.
Right, that's a great idea. Yeah, I mean that sounds like a more like a field experiment than a lab experiment, because you'd probably want to do it in a fairly realistic environment. But maybe there's a clever way to do it in a lab. No, that's interesting. Yeah. I mean, it is a sort of remarkable observation about the online world that you do see these sort of very kind of different tenors, and the former is more prevalent than the latter. You see a lot of pretty low level commentary. I mean, you could manipulate things like getting rid of anonymity, for example. That would probably have a big impact, but it would probably also dramatically reduce the number of comments that you would get. So, anyway. Yes, we could do things like that. Is there another question here? Yeah.
In the first part of your speech, I caught something about where there was equality of pay and versus non-equality of pay or remuneration for participating.
Mm-hmm.
And I just wonder if you're going to have any. Your research is going to carry you to that direction, where envy gets involved and that sort of thing.
Right. No. So we were very careful not to let people know what other people were getting paid. But that would be an interesting variation. I would certainly have hypotheses about what would happen if you knew that someone else was getting paid 10 times as much to do exactly the same job.
Yeah. That's
but of course, that's where women have that problem, right?
Well, society has that problem.
Well, no. Well, in this society, there's women. When you control for pretty much everything that you can control for, women get paid about 90% of what equivalent men get paid. Is anyone going to stand up and say they don't do as good? Anyone other than Larry Summers, maybe, are they going to stand up and say that they don't do as good a job? So clearly, there's something sort of a bit off about the idea that how much you pay someone motivates their performance. You could also ask the same thing about CEOs in Europe and versus CEOs in the US. There's a huge discrepancy in pay. But do we think that European CEOs are less talented or hardworking? You could conduct a thought experiment on your own compensation. Imagine that your employer next year doubles your salary, right? Are you going to work any harder? Are you going to do a better job? I mean, you're probably already working as hard as you can, right? You're probably already doing about as good a job as you can. So I think there are real limits to how much performance we can extract using financial incentives. And there's lots of other evidence about that as well. Yes, Jennifer.
So two things that caught me were you're throwing people into preordained structures. So I wonder, the way that we fit into networks in natural social systems is networks develop over time. And then time is the other issue. You're having people play to 10 rounds and then stop. And then you're also having people who repeat many 10-round games. But again, that's not reflective of sort of time, how networks interact over time. So I wonder what you have to say about those two issues.
Well, the first one is relatively straightforward, and we actually already have plans to run a new round of experiments where we endogenize the network formation becomes part of the game itself, right? And then you can ask, like, when what kinds of networks, are there sort of certain kinds of networks that turn out to be equilibria of certain kinds of games, and if so, what are they, and are there are there sort of rules of network formation that also improve some outcome that you care about? So that's complicated, but it's perfectly doable within the current framework. The second one is more difficult, but the kinds of real world outcomes that we often care about are things that happen over long periods of time. So that's a much more challenging exercise for this sort of platform. But you know, there may be things you could, creative things you could do there as well. Like if you sort of had people play games on their smartphones, right? They have like a download an app, and then and they can continue to play this game, over weeks or months, right? And that would bring in other kinds of confounding factors as well. There's never going to be a perfect solution, but I haven't really thought much about what to do with phones, right? How you could sort of utilize that platform to, but I'm sure there's lots of interesting things. Right. Yes. So there are definitely people who are very keen on phones.
Thank you. Really appreciate it.
Okay. I guess we're done. Thank you.